Hello everyone and welcome back to my channel. In the past, it was easy to suggest a type of posterior crown for a patient. It was either a metal or a PFM. But today, we have so many material options that even we dentists get confused suggesting the best option. This video will give you a clear understanding of the materials available to us and the different case scenarios where each would be preferred. First, do you know the difference between a monolithic and a layered crown? So monolithic is basically made of only one material, while a layered crown consists of multiple layers. For example, a porcelain fused to metal or a porcelain fused to zirconia, where you have a metal or zirconia coping and a porcelain layer on top. Remember this information, guys. It's extremely important you know this because it makes a huge difference in crown selection. For starters, a layered crown requires more preparation compared to a monolithic crown, which you may not always have the liberty to do so. On this note, we will discuss our first monolithic crown material, that is the metal crowns. So the best thing about a metal crown is that it doesn't require too much of tooth preparation and it conserves the tooth structure. It is strong and durable. And because of this property, it doesn't have to be very bulky. So even in thinner cross sections, they have adequate strength. It also does not abrade the opposing natural teeth as much when you compare it to ceramics. But the biggest disadvantage and the reason that most people don't opt for metal crowns these days is its unaesthetic appearance. Another disadvantage, or rather a contraindication for a metal crown, is if a patient gives a history of metal allergy. This allergic reaction happens if you give a nickel chromium alloy crown. People can be allergic to the nickel and it causes contact dermatitis. In patients allergic to metal, it is safer to go with metal-free crowns like zirconia. Second common material that we use is a porcelain fused to metal or a PFM crown. These have been used successfully for the last few decades. What made it popular in the past was its acceptable durability and aesthetics. Currently, although we have better aesthetic crowns, it is still the most economical option among those. The major drawback of PFM is that it is extremely invasive when it comes to tooth reduction, as you need to make space for both the metal coping and the ceramic layer on top. These are the least conservative of all materials out there. Secondly, if the preparation is inadequate or heavy masticatory forces are applied on one part of the crown, chances of porcelain chipping is very high. I'm sure you all must have seen fractured or chipped off porcelain crowns in your dental practice. So these are some things that you need to remember. Apart from these, we have porcelain fused to zirconia or PFZ. So they are similar to PFM, except here you have zirconia coping. These crowns give you a better fit and aesthetics compared to conventional PFM. The disadvantages of PFM and PFZ are more or less the same, which includes excessive tooth reduction, however less than PFM crowns, and chipping of the porcelain. Next, we have the zirconia crowns. Very popular these days. They are known for their excellent strength and durability. Monolithic zirconia is considered to be the strongest of the prosthetic crowns. Again, these crowns don't require too much preparation because, like mentioned earlier, these are monolithic, so only one material. So it conserves the tooth structure and they don't have to be as bulky like PFM or PFZ. The disadvantages of these crowns is that they tend to abrade the opposing natural dentition, especially if left unpolished. Also, zirconia inherently is opaque and it is stained on the outside. So the aesthetic properties of monolithic zirconia crowns are not that great. Obviously, these days you do have better translucent zirconia, which are more aesthetic. So talk to your lab technician about the different materials that they are using, so you have an overall idea about what you can advise your patient. The last option that we have here is the lithium disilicate crown, popularly known as the EMAX crowns. These crowns give a natural, lifelike appearance, and nothing beats a lithium disilicate crown when it comes to aesthetics. These crowns are bonded to the underlying tooth structure, unlike other crowns which have to be luted with a cement. They are known to have considerably less strength, but its ability to bond to enamel increases the strength exponentially. I would also like to add that there are a lot of new materials which are developed and are being developed in search for an ideal restorative material. You have the hybrid ceramics, which are a combination of ceramic and composites, which seem pretty promising in terms of strength, aesthetic, and minimally invasive preparations. Then you have the indirect reinforced composite blocks as well, with improved mechanical properties. A popular opinion among many is that composites are the future in restorative dentistry. We only need to wait and watch and see what the future holds for us. So here we have very briefly discussed the main advantages and disadvantages of the commonly used materials. And now we shall discuss some clinical applications of these prosthetic materials and an explanation of what crown to choose and what not depending on the case. I really hope this helps you all. First, we shall discuss the most common parafunctional habit that mainly includes clenching and grinding of teeth, which we all know as bruxism. In a bruxer, the most common failure when it comes to crown and bridges is a fracture of material due to heavy masticatory forces, especially when you are giving a layered prosthesis. This can be your PFM, PFZ, layered zirconia, or a layered lithium disilicate crown. Another failure reported in bruxers is failure of retention of crowns or crowns being frequently dislodged. And what is the reason behind this? Naturally, in bruxers you will find worn out teeth or teeth with already short clinical crown height. So when you prepare a tooth for a crown, what will happen? Obviously, the length of the crown decreases further. And to make things worse, if you end up giving a layered prosthesis, you will be left with barely any tooth structure, and your retention and resistance form is compromised, leading to crown dislodgement. So rule number one, you need to give an accurately fitting crown which requires minimal tooth reduction. So preferably, give a monolithic crown in these patients. So monolithic can be metal, zirconia, and lithium disilicate. Now among these, the best option according to me and my experience is a metal crown. Metal crowns are known to be wear friendly also, so it won't abrade the opposing teeth as much. If your patient wants an aesthetically pleasing crown, then the next best option in a bruxer would be a monolithic zirconia. The only issue that I have with zirconia is that it may have a tendency to abrade the opposing teeth, especially if your crown is unpolished or even glazed. Since we are on the topic of zirconia causing wear of opposing dentition, please remember this. Whenever you're giving a zirconia crown, give a polished zirconia instead of a glazed one. So you need to tell this to your lab technician. You know what a glaze is, right? It is a thin layer which is usually applied on the crown to give it a glossy surface. So what happens with a glazed crown is that during wear process, which is very pronounced in the bruxer, correct? The glaze layer comes out and the underlying surface is usually not polished. And this unpolished surface accelerates enamel wear. And there has been a lot of research on glazed versus polished zirconia crowns, and polished zirconia crowns have always been recommended because they show a favorable wear behavior opposing natural teeth. Second case scenario that I would like to discuss is a short clinical crown height or a less interocclusal space. Like previously mentioned, here you cannot give a PFM, PFZ or any layered restoration because these restorations having multiple layers require more preparation and you don't have the liberty to do that in such cases, correct? So in these cases, which would be a preferred crown? A monolithic crown, right? So it can be a monolithic zirconia, lithium disilicate or a DMLS metal crown if the patient is looking for a more economical option. Always go for a CAD-CAM fabricated crown because these crowns have a superior fit, whether it is a milled or a laser sintered crown. If you want to know more about the management of a short clinical crown height, you may want to check out the video that I have posted on the topic. The link is given in the description box. So now, what if you have an aesthetically demanding patient? Which crown is preferred in such cases? Now obviously in this video I'm discussing only posterior crown. So if a tooth is in the aesthetic zone like a premolar, or sometimes you just have a patient who even wants a posterior teeth to resemble the other natural teeth, the preferable option is lithium disilicate because nothing beats an Emax or a lithium disilicate when it comes to aesthetics. You're probably thinking that these materials don't even have enough strength and they're mainly indicated for anterior teeth. But the thing is that a lithium disilicate or an Emax crown, unlike the other crowns, are bonded to the underlying tooth structure. And that considerably increases the strength and fracture resistance of the crowns. And these days, improved lithium disilicate crown materials are developed with greater strength. And not only that, we do have research and evidence supporting the use of lithium disilicate for posterior restorations. The second best option would be to go for a translucent zirconia. If you have enough space, you can even go for a porcelain fused to zirconia. In fact, you can even suggest a PFM crown, but it's not going to be as aesthetic as the other three options. I will be uploading a video to talk more about zirconia and lithium disilicate, everything in detail about the properties, the latest type, uses, the preparation guidelines, etc. So watch out for that and try not to miss it. Okay. Question. Can you guess in what case you will have to give a PFM or a metal crown? Because zirconia or lithium disilicate have not yet evolved in that aspect of prosthetic restorations. Cases which require precision attachments, like cast partial dentures, especially in distal extension cases. If you're planning to give a precision attachment, then you have no other option but to go for a metal or PFM, because only with these crowns an attachment can be fabricated. Moving on, I would like to discuss a few aspects of using these materials for a bridge or a multiple unit fixed prosthesis. When it comes to bridges, metal bridges are inherently strong and you don't really have a problem with those. PFM is also okay because of the metal substructure it has. The problem arises when you give a long span bridge where you want to replace more than two teeth, which honestly isn't the ideal thing to replace with a bridge. Instead, you should opt for an implant or a cast partial denture in those cases. Anyway, coming back.
So in PFM crowns, metal undergoes flexion under occlusal load. Due to this, the overlying brittle porcelain tends to fracture or chip off from the metal. So that is one disadvantage.
When it comes to zirconia, Emax or PFZ, the forces are concentrated on the connector area, which is considered to be the weakest link, resulting in fracture. These materials require at least 3 to 4 mm of the connector height and width for a bridge. The height is measured from the gingival to occlusal surface and the width buccolingually. So in cases of short clinical crown height or where there is less interocclusal space, you need to take care. Either you can gain additional crown length with crown lengthening procedure or avoid giving a bridge with these materials. With this, we come to an end. If you haven't already, kindly subscribe to the channel. I hope this video will help you make the right decisions when it comes to choosing a posterior crown. If you have any questions, don't hesitate to mention it in the comment section below. And always remember that the crown you suggest your patient will always depend on the case in front of you. And if you still believe that any random material can be used for any case, you're wrong here and you will encounter failures with your restorations. It is imperative to have a knowledge about the materials that you're dealing with. Work in sync with your lab technician for the best results.